Der Schicker ruft ihn.
Madam Speaker.
Please hold to your seat. He is speaking.
Madam Speaker, I just wish to begin by saying, that I am fully in support of my colleagues' demands that this parliament should create a joint parliamentary committee on the Rafale deal. But I believe this bill is important and therefore I will speak on it. But I want to stress that my speaking is not dissociating from the very strong stand taken by my party. Now, Madam Speaker, the Congress party has been asking for a transgender bill for some time. But the bill given to us by this government is a deeply flawed bill. I myself have had to submit 21 amendments. If this bill is going to get my party's support, it needs to be reconsidered. And I want to stress, madam, I am proud to represent Tirunelveli, which witnessed the first legally registered trans couple marriage in Kerala in May of this year. I also stand here as a proud Indian because our country has a rich heritage by holding members of the transgender community in very high regard. We've accepted their place in society. According to Hindu theology, as you know, Lord Ram gave the transgenders the power to confer blessings on people. The Aravanis in Tamil Nadu themselves consider themselves to be the children of both Aravan and the female form of Vishnu, namely Mohini. It must be noted that the transgender community has played an important role in the royal courts of the Mughals as well. We should remember that our country is home to the oldest transgender community in the world, the Hijra community. But sadly, with the advent of the British and the searing of archaic Victorian ideas of morality on our constitution and our minds, we have seen havoc created in India for transgender people, especially after the adoption of the Criminal Tribes Act 1871, which deemed the entire community as a criminal tribe. The British have moved on. They have now adopted progressive laws like the UK Gender Recognition Act. But we are continuing the old negative British colonial legacy, and their prejudice against the transgender community is continuing in this country. They're subjected to discrimination in all forms, subjected to mental and physical abuse and sexual abuse. They're denied jobs. Many are abandoned by their families. And this is why my party has always said it's time that we should take important legislative and policy steps to correct this anomaly, this injustice against the transgender community. We, of course, know that the Article 14 of our Constitution says that every person has equality before the law. It doesn't say man or woman, it says person, which means everybody in the gender spectrum has equality in our country. Article 15 and 16 prohibits discrimination on the grounds of sex. The Supreme Court, as the Honourable Minister has mentioned, has made it clear that the word sex in the Constitution includes any gender identity and not merely the binary of male or female. The need of the hour is a robust law which can transform these gender-inclusive constitutional values into ground reality. But, Madam Speaker, this is where the bill is a flawed bill. It does not give us the robustness that we seek. You know, the law must clearly define and recognize transgender persons if we are going to protect their rights. But we need to recognize that the term gender identity goes beyond the biological issues of male and female. In fact, we have principles established internationally for all this, the Yogyakarta principles, which say that gender identity is an individual's deep and personal experience. It need not correspond to the sex assigned at birth. It includes a personal sense of the body and other expressions, such as one's own personal idiosyncrasies. And the sad thing is the bill that has been given to us by the government still uses phrases like neither wholly female nor wholly male, or combination of female or male, while defining a transgender person, which confines the transgenders to a biological determination of gender, which is reminiscent of the regressive and outdated principles rejected by the Supreme Court of India. The so-called Corbett principles have been rejected by the Supreme Court, but the minister who has mentioned the Supreme Court still has put this into his bill. The government has blindly borrowed this definition from the definition of intersex persons under Australian law. From what we have seen in our research, persons who have variations in their primary sexual characteristics and their biological features, when compared with the normative standard of female or male bodies, are referred to as intersex. We can't confuse the two here. I had written to the minister on the 1st of January of this year to tell him to revise the definition of transgender persons. And while I'm glad that he has agreed to drop his earlier definition and has adopted a large part of the definition that I'm proposing before this House, the definition he's pushing for is still defective, as it deems all intersex persons to be transgender persons. The point is that Clause 3 of the bill prohibits discriminatory practices against transgender persons, but it fails to define discrimination, and it limits itself to only 9 types of practices. It prohibits certain acts, but it fails to specify the civil or criminal liability that may arise if somebody commits these acts. It is important for us to redraft this clause so we have an inclusive definition, so that practices which may not be stipulated under the provision but which violate the rights of transgender persons are covered under the ambit of the Act. The law must make it clear that even transgender persons without a certificate of gender identity must be allowed to complain of gender discrimination, Madam Speaker. Clause 12 of the bill states that every establishment consisting of 100 or more persons shall designate a person to be a complaint officer to deal with complaints relating to the provisions of this Act. But Madam, the average employment size of any economic establishment in India is 2 to 3 people. According to the 6th economic census, we are a country of smaller micro enterprises. How can we have such a high numerical threshold when the bill will exclude, therefore, a majority of the establishments in India? Furthermore, the bill does not specify a mechanism to deal with complaints. It doesn't lay down a timetable to redress grievances. The redressal system is a complete failure from start to finish in this bill. The bill has prescribed a procedure involving a district screening committee to certify someone as a transgender person. Whereas we in the Congress Party on every occasion have insisted that self-determination of gender is the integral part of personal autonomy, and that we cannot take away the liberty of the person to say, I believe I am transgender, by putting a committee to decide for this person what gender the person should belong to. This is, by the way, a fundamental right affirmed under Article 21 by the Supreme Court of India. And it cannot be abridged by a district screening committee. What is the minister thinking if he's going to ask a district screening committee to do something which the Supreme Court has said cannot be done? I want to stress also that this committee has a chief medical officer. A medical officer will do physical tests. Any form of such physical test to determine whether a person is transgender violates the dignity, the privacy and the autonomy of the transgender person. It must be vehemently opposed and even prohibited, Madam Speaker. Now, the fact is we need an identity provision so that people can actually be beneficiaries of the provisions envisaged in this bill. But what the minister should do is amend the law, take into account these suggestions, prescribe a swift time-bound approach whereby a transgender person can make or submit a self-declaration of gender to the district magistrate, supported by a report from a registered psychologist or psychiatrist. Right now we've got complete red tape and an inefficient bureaucratic system. The law must also prescribe a time-bound procedure if somebody wants to change their gender, change their name. All of this should have been similar to Section 3 of the Gender Expression, Gender Identity and Sex Characteristic Practices, of the best practices in the world. Malta has a bill like this. We are very happy to convey to the government very specific amendments that will help the minister fulfill these objectives. His bill sets up a national council to advise the government on its policies relating to the transgender community. But the composition of the council doesn't represent the various diverse groups within the transgender community. The council has no power to deal with grievances of members of the community. And surely, if you're going to have district offices, you need state councils to set up along with the national council on the same principle as the National Human Rights Commission and the state's human rights commissions. We need the same for this too. Now, there's a vexed question of sexual abuse. Per clause 19D of the bill, a person who subjects a transgender person to sexual abuse gets punishment of minimum 6 months. It's highly discriminatory as well as insulting, Madam Speaker. When women are subject to sexual offences, we must have harsh levels of punishment. The whole House supported our bill on that. Why should transgender persons be treated as second-class citizens who get much smaller punishment if they are abused? This is a violation of Article 14 of the Constitution. And I would urge the Minister to amend this bill whereby all applicable provisions under the IPC should apply when sexual offences are committed against transgender persons. A sexual offence is a sexual offence. Whether the victim is a woman, a man, a child, there are very precise laws. Why should the transgenders not also require that abuse of their person would attract the same kind of punishment? The criminalization of those who entice transgender persons to beg is also completely revealing the government's lack of understanding on matters of the transgender community. Very often they do beg. We know the hijras come often at traffic lights. They work in collectives or groups and beg. But this provision will be used to target such groups. The hijra community has so many practices in our culture where they come and get gifts, money or arms at times of wedding and other celebrations. If we consider them begging, suddenly this law will criminalize most hijra behavior of this nature. I also fear that the bill is completely omitted to address critical issues such as the application of laws of marriage, divorce and inheritance for members of the transgender community. Even though the Supreme Court rules that transgender persons are entitled to reservations, this has been neglected in the bill. So my worry, Madam Speaker, I'll summarize, is that instead of supplementing the constitutional rights of the transgender community, this bill actually supplants their rights, and its flawed provisions defeat the very purpose of the legislation. I had pointed out these flaws before to the Minister in my letter of January 2018. I once again urge him to withdraw his bill, to consult the transgender community, and to introduce a robust and comprehensive legislation for our consideration. Madam Speaker, my party is prepared to support a constructive bill. We have in the past spoken for the rights of transgenders, but this bill is not it. And Madam, given the disturbance in the House, that many are not participating, given the legitimate demand of my party for a JPC on Rafale, may I request that you defer consideration, that the Minister will rethink his bill, look at these amendments, and bring the issue back to the House where we can have a serious, serious discussion and decision. I thank you, Madam Speaker. Please request the Minister to withdraw.